gathered round the table. So much to be thankful for. It's Christmas. Oh, how I've missed this. But through the joy and laughter, you can feel the sadness. 'Cause it's Christmas, everyone's not with us.
It's the time of year when happiness and cheer won't be enough to get me through the night. I need a wonderful
tell you a story about the very first Christmas. Long ago, there lived a young woman named Mary. One day, an angel named Gabriel appeared to Mary and he said,
Behold,
you shall have a son,
and you shall name him Jesus.
For he will be the Son of the Most High.
Just before the baby was born, Mary and her husband Joseph traveled to a little town called
Bethlehem.
When they arrived in the town, they tried to find a place to sleep.
But there was no room in the inn.
No room in the inn?
The innkeeper told Mary and Joseph that they could sleep in the stable. That very night, Mary's baby was born.
His name was Jesus.
She wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger.
And the bright star twinkled in the sky above.
And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and at first they were frightened.
But the angel said to them,
Do not be afraid.
I bring you good news of great joy.
To Today, a Savior has been born to you.
He is the Messiah, the Lord.
This is a sign for you, a baby wrapped in cloth lying in a manger.
When the angels went away, the shepherds followed the star to Bethlehem. When the shepherds reached the stable in Bethlehem, their hearts were filled with happiness, and they knelt beside the sleeping baby Jesus.
Far away to the east,
three wise men saw a blazing star in the sky.
They were overjoyed.
They knew this meant a great king had been born.
Oh, a great king has been born.
A great king had been born.
So they followed the star to Bethlehem, and when they found the baby, they bowed and worshiped him. The three wise men presented Jesus with gifts of
gold,
frankincense,
and myrrh.
And myrrh.
And they said, behold.
Behold the Son of God.
The birth of Jesus brought hope to many people. He was the Son of God, sent to save all those who believe in him. And today, we celebrate the wonder of the very first Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Happy Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
All right, Hope City. Jesus, we just praise you because you are so worthy. We love you, and God, we just ask that you would fill this whole service with yourself, Lord, that for the heart that feels distant, God, that we would be reminded that your word says that when we draw near to you, you draw near to us. It's not dependent on our feelings or our circumstances or what we've done right or wrong that day. We thank you so much, God, that you are Emmanuel, God with us, a God that wants to be close, and yet you are still mighty and magnificent and holy and better than anything we could ever ask or imagine. And so, God, we just pray that you'd help our hearts to be focused on you tonight, that we would embrace this Christmas and the reason why we celebrate. We love you, Jesus, and it's in your name that we all said, amen, amen. Go ahead, take a seat.
All right, there we go. Welcome, Hope City. Hey, can we give a huge round of applause for our band and our worship team? That was amazing. It was incredible. Well, Merry Christmas. We're so happy you're here. My name is Isaiah. I'm a student and volunteer here.
And my name is Wes. And Isaiah, I must say, those shoes are beautiful.
Did you get Thank those
for,
you.
For Christmas? Christmas gift?
I wish. They've been locked in my closet for about a couple years, actually, because they're for special occasions. I think this is a pretty special occasion, I would say. So
excellent. You look great. Shoes look great. And we just want to welcome you tonight to the Christmas Eve service. If you are new here, we want to especially welcome you. And you can go out after the service out the back door. There's a place called Next Steps. You can find out more about the church. And we also have an incredible free gift for you. It's a beautiful red coffee mug. It'd be perfect, especially if you haven't finished your Christmas shopping. All the stores are closed, but you can go back there and say you're new. And I don't want to call out anybody, Aaron, but if you have shopping to do that you need to finish, tell them you're new. No, but seriously though, there is a great way that you can connect with the church, find out more about classes and ways to connect here. We want to especially welcome you tonight.
Yeah, absolutely. Speaking of connecting, we're going to go into our Connect 15. So this is 15 seconds to turn to a neighbor. If you're online, to type in the chat. So turn to somebody and ask them what their favorite Christmas movie is.
All right, and at this time, we want to welcome our greeters to come forward. We're going to enter into a time of offering. And at Hope City, we have tons of people who are incredibly generous, and that allows things like tonight to happen. We've got fires outside, we've got hot chocolate, we've got $200,000 worth of firewood outside from Kroger. No, not really. But I do want to put a plug in tonight. You can also give to the Give Hope campaign, which is going to allow us into this next year to do a few different things. One of those things is give us a building fund, as we're looking for a permanent church home. It'll also allow us to find a youth pastor, and it'll continue to help us partner with other people outside of these walls, like Urban Act Academy, which is downtown. And we, so far, have already hit our goal of $10,000 to give to Urban Act Academy. So that is incredible. We've already met that goal. But we can still give. There's still time to give to the Hope, Give Hope campaign, and we're so thankful for so many generous hearts here at Hope City.
Yeah, absolutely. It's amazing. So now we have some awesome stuff lined up here at Hope City, so check out this video.
Every year at Hope City, we take the Sunday after Christmas off so we can enjoy time with family. So this Sunday, December 26th, we will not be having service, but we're excited to see you online for an online-only service on January 2nd. We're starting the new year with a new semester of Financial Peace University. FPU uses biblical principles to help you take control of your money, plan for your future, and transform your life. Financial Peace is a 9-week class happening here at Hope City on Thursdays at 6:30 p.m. The first class is on January 20th. To register for this class, text FPU to 317-943-8773 and start your new year with big transformation.
Again, we're so excited that you're here tonight to celebrate with us, and we have a great message from Pastor Justin as we celebrate Christmas at Hope City.
What is up, guys? How we doing? Very good? Well, Merry Christmas. Oh, my gosh. Merry Christmas. Thank you. All right. No, I'm like, man, is nobody excited about Christmas as I am? I love Christmas. You know what? Last night, my daughter said to me, she said, Dad, there's fire pits. Are you happy? And that really, I'm a simple man. All it takes is fire pits on Christmas Eve to make me happy. And I'm so glad that you guys are here to celebrate with us. My name is Justin, one of the pastors here. And if you are a guest with us tonight, and we've been praying about this evening, we've been planning this evening, we're especially grateful that you are here tonight. And I'd love to meet you out at the Next Steps table after the service, just to wish you a Merry Christmas. And one of the things we say around here all the time is that Hope City is a place where you can belong before you believe. So no matter where you come from today spiritually, we hope that you feel at home, and that's never more true than at Christmas. Well, if you guys have been around Hope City for a little while, you know my obsession with the Starbucks and the Chick-fil-A app. It's just kind of something, even before the pandemic, I was an early adopter of the Starbucks app, and it was convenient, right? But also, I just kind of have a competition addiction. And so I always have a competition with the people who are actually in line as I walk past all of them to grab my drink and then taunt them on the way out of Starbucks, right? And I do the same thing at Chick-fil-A. I say that I'm here when I'm not there just so they prepare my food, and then I just walk in, right? And the Chick-fil-A, you know, traffic is backed up like, you know, 7 miles, and people are cussing each other trying to get in up at Westfield, and I'm just walking in, grabbing my stuff, and I'm walking out, right? And so I've been an early adopter now. The pandemic kind of changed everything because all kinds of, you know, restaurants now have apps where you can order. Chipotle does that. You know, you can do that at Jimmy John's now, like all these things. So the playing field is a little bit more even now. And so my latest obsession this season, this Christmas, has been the Amazon app. And you're like, dude, really? You're that old? Like, Amazon's been around for a while. Now, here's the deal. I don't know what happened a few weeks ago, but all of a sudden, I didn't turn on notifications, but all of a sudden, I get a notification on my phone that says, your package is 10 stops away. Anybody else getting this? Or is it just me? Is it just my, okay, all right. Isn't that amazing? And so, like, your package is 10 stops away. Your package is less than 7 stops away. Your package is almost there. And then the dreaded time killer notification, you can track your package on an app, on the app. And so I'm like, what do I have to do the week of Christmas Eve? I'm just going to watch my packages, right? I'm just sitting on the UPS guy's next door. Oh, the UPS guy's 3 miles away. Oh, why did it take so long at that house, right? I'm tracking this guy. Did he make a wrong turn? He's doing a U-turn right now, right? And I'm just watching, just killing time. And then the best notification possible, especially if one of your love languages is gifts, like my love language is gifts, your package has arrived. It's unbelievable, right? I love it. And so I don't know what I'm going to do with like 8 or 10 hours of my week now that Christmas is going to be coming to an end tomorrow. I'll have to figure out something else to kill time with, but I've just been loving this app of tracking the package from 10 stops away. That's unbelievable. Jeff Bezos is a genius, right? No wonder he's a billionaire. Now, over the last few weeks, we've been in this series here at Hope City called Wonder, and we've been talking about how to rediscover the wonder of Christmas. Because I don't know if it's because I'm getting older, I don't know if it's because of our culture, I don't know if it's a combination of things, but it's hard to keep the wonder of Christmas, right? It's hard to stand in awe of God when so many things are going on in our world. It's hard to keep the nostalgia of Christmas when we have all kinds of things that are coming against us and all kinds of things in the news that are trying to bring us down and all kinds of things in our culture that are working against the wonder that God created us to experience when it comes to Christmas. But what if I told you that the entire Old Testament was like this huge notification from God to you and to me that your gift is coming? Your gift is less than 10 stops away. Your gift is right around the corner. Your gift, you can track it on the map because your gift is about to arrive. The gift I have for you is coming. The gift I have for you is close. The Bible as we have it today, this is, if you're a skeptic, if you kind of have a hard time believing in God or maybe believing in the Bible, or maybe you kind of grew up in church and then you went to college and you kind of fell away from God, and now you look at the Bible or you come to church and you think, well, that's a good story, but I don't really know if that's believable. That's a good story. Did that miracle really happen? Is that really just an illustration? Is that really just a fable? Is that really just a fairy tale? Is it really just kind of a good story with a nice meaning? One of the reasons why I believe that God's Word, why I believe that the Bible is the infallible Word of God, is because it creates a sense of wonder just in how it's written. The Bible was written over a span of 2,000 years by 40 different authors on 3 different continents in 3 different languages. Now, this is before algorithms. This is before AI. This is before any way of trying to accumulate and organize information like that. But by the divine hand of God and by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, 40 different people wrote all the same story, all pointing to the same person. Talk about wonder. Shepherds, kings, scholars, fishermen, prophets, a military general, a cupbearer to the king, and a priest all wrote parts of the Bible. And through God's divine providence and God's divine timing, he brought all of those things together to communicate this notification to you tonight. The gift is coming. They're all telling the same story. Your gift is coming. Your gift is close. There's over 300 notifications in the Old Testament, over 300 prophecies that point to the birth and the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus. 300. Here's just a few of them that usher in the wonder of Christmas. Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14 says, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and he will be called Emmanuel." 740 years before the birth of Jesus, Isaiah says, hey, this birth is going to be very unique. We're going to put two words in the same sentence that do not go together. The virgin will conceive. It was as wacky then as it is now. It didn't make sense, but it was a prophecy. It was a notification that, hey, your gift is coming. And then Isaiah says he's going to be called Emmanuel. He's going to be called God with us. And for the people that heard that prophecy, for the people that heard Isaiah say those words, they went back to God's promise of a Messiah. He's going to be God with us. How about Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6? "For a child is born to us, a son is given to us. The government will rest on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." 740 years before the birth of Jesus, God is using the prophet Isaiah to say, hey, I have a gift coming for you. And then Isaiah uses words that would have been reserved for only deity. He uses words to describe Jesus that the Jewish people would only use to talk about Jehovah, the one true God. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. It's just this notification 740 years ahead of the delivery. Your gift is coming, and it's going to be incredible. How about Micah chapter 5, verse 2? "But you, O Bethlehem, are a small village among all the people of Judah. Yet a ruler of Israel, whose origins are in the distant past, will come from you on my behalf." This is God's voice speaking through the prophet Micah. Have you ever put an address in your phone, it would be an Apple Maps or Google or Waze, and it takes you to a place that's different than the address that you put in? Trish and I were in Orlando a few years ago, and we put in Starbucks, which is very common, I think, in every town, but especially Orlando. It took us to a field with a bunch of gas pumps in it. Trish was like, "I don't think this is where we're supposed to be," right? Like, sometimes you can put in directions, and you go, "I don't think this is where the map was supposed to take us." Well, 500 years before Jesus is born, Micah comes out with the location of the birth of the Messiah. It's not London. It's not New York City. It's not Jerusalem. It's not Istanbul. It's Bethlehem, town of 200 people. Of all of the predictions that you could make about the birth of the Messiah, to call your shot on Bethlehem. As the great movie Hoosiers would say, it doesn't appear on most state maps. All right? If you're under 40, you don't get that. But if you are over 40, you know what I'm talking about. But Micah tells us this gift will be delivered in Bethlehem. And people would have to say, what? Bethlehem? Why Bethlehem? And then Micah establishes the eternal essence of Jesus. And he says, his origins are in the distant past. It has this eternal nature to that statement. How about this one? Numbers chapter 24, verse 17. The writer of Numbers is a guy named Moses. And Moses says, I see him, but not now. I behold him, but not near. A star will come out of Jacob. A scepter will rise out of Israel. 1,500 years before the birth of Jesus, Moses says, hey, I see the gift is coming. It's more than 10 stops away. It's not near at all, but I see it. And then he says that there's going to be a star that's going to guide this journey. He says, I can see the gift, but it's not near yet. Just look for the star. See, the wonder of Christmas, it's not just found on what took place on Christmas Eve night. It's not just found on what took place Christmas Day. The wonder of Jesus was this buildup, this anticipation, this story that God told for over 2,000 years amongst 40 different authors across three continents in three different languages, all coming together to tell the same story then that they tell now, and that is the Messiah is coming. The gift is coming. Your gift is about to arrive. And then in Luke chapter 2, it's this declaration that your gift has been delivered. And that's the traditional Christmas story. Let's look at it together. Verses 8 through 20. That night there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. Suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them, and they were terrified. But the angel reassured them. Don't be afraid, he said. I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David. And you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth, lying in a manger. And suddenly the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest heaven and peace on earth to those with whom God is pleased. When the angels had returned to heaven, the shepherds said to each other, let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about. They hurried to a village and found Mary and Joseph there. And there was the baby lying in the manger. After seeing him, the shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary kept all of these things in her heart and thought about them. The shepherds went back to their flocks, glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and seen, for it was just as the angel had told them. So how can you rediscover wonder this Christmas? No matter where you come from tonight, no matter your life circumstances, your financial situation, your work environment, no matter how your marriage is, no matter how your dating life is, no matter whether you got one present under the tree at home or 100 presents under the tree at home, how can we rediscover the wonder of the Christmas story? This is my 26th year talking about the Christmas story. And so it's hard to recapture that wonder. So I want to just give you just a few things that you can take with you as you enter into Christmas Day tomorrow. The first is to slow down and see his birth. Slow down and see his birth. Do you feel unseen or insignificant this Christmas? Maybe even here in a room full of people, if you were just completely honest, you feel insignificant. You feel unseen. Can I just tell you that the Son of God has been there? When you think about the birth of the King of Kings, when you think about the birth of the Messiah, the Savior of the world, the hoopla and the surrounding environment around that event would probably look something like this, is what you would think. Right? That's Prince William and Kate Middleton leaving the hospital after their first child is born. And people are everywhere. They have security guards everywhere. They have people blocked off. It was a big deal. Social media almost broke that day. Right? Everyone wanted to talk about this baby. But Jesus' birth was completely opposite of this. It was completely insignificant. There was no gender reveal. There was no baby showers. There were no world leaders calling to congratulate Mary and Joseph. There was no room in the inn. Think about the juxtaposition of this birth announcement that just took place after the birth of Jesus. Angels appear in the sky, which is absolutely spectacular, all right? That's amazing. And they start announcing that the gift has arrived. And after the angel appears, the Bible says that the armies of heaven appear. The armies of heaven show up. One commentator said that the Greek translation of that would be thousands of thousands. So thousands of thousands of angels. So there is just this huge turnout of angels, and they're all praising God. They're all singing about God's glory. And these angels share this wonderful news. Not with social media influencers, not with heads of state, not with the 10 richest people in Forbes. They share it with shepherds. What? They're the lowest of the low. They're the poorest of the poor. They were so marginalized and so put off in that society, and they were considered so untrustworthy that if a shepherd witnessed a crime, you couldn't even call a shepherd into a court of law to testify because they were that unbelievable. They were that crooked. They were that dishonest. This isn't in my notes. So to think about how the shepherds go and they tell everybody, and it says, and the people were amazed at what the shepherds told them, that is a miracle in and of itself. And so these shepherds are the first to receive this birth announcement. And what do they tell them? They say, hey, go find Jesus at Walter Reed Memorial Hospital. No. They say, go find Jesus at Buckingham Palace. No. Go find Jesus at the presidential suite of the Ritz-Carlton. No. You're not even going to Jerusalem to find Jesus. You're going to a stable in a trough outside of a town of 200 called Bethlehem, and that's where you're going to find the King of Kings. That's where you're going to find the Lord of Lords. That's where you're going to find the Messiah. So let me just tell you tonight, if you have a dream that has not come into fruition, if you have a relationship that has not reached its potential yet, if you have something in your life that feels forgotten, overlooked, or completely dismissed by God, the Son of God gets you. And so take some time to look at the birth of Jesus. And what you're going to realize is that his birth is a reminder that God's greatest miracles often have small beginnings. Christmas is this reminder that the biggest miracle in the history of mankind had the most insignificant beginning. Secondly, look up and see a star. Do you feel lost this Christmas? I mean, you know where you are physically, but maybe spiritually lost, maybe relationally lost. Last Thursday, we had a party at our house for our volunteers. And we didn't have a volunteer party last year, and so we were really excited to host the volunteer party this year. And we sold our house in June, and we moved to the north side of Zionsville. And our new house, it sits like probably 400 yards off of a county road called 400, I don't know what it's called, but anyway, it's north of Zionsville. And it's like, it's called Ford Road, and then it turns into a county road like right before our house, and it messes up all kinds of maps. And so people started showing up, and then I could see cars out in front of our house. They would go this way, and they would turn around my neighbor's driveway, and they'd go back this way, and I could see them. They'd come back this way, they're going back and forth, back and forth. And finally, I went out on my porch, and I started waving cars in, like, hey, you're at the right place. And those that used Waze were taken to the elementary school down the street. Those that used Apple Maps were taken to the neighborhood across the street. And everybody's like, man, I had such a hard time finding your house. I put in the address that was the right address. They follow the directions, they just end up in the wrong place. And maybe that's how some of you feel this Christmas. Like you're trying to follow God, but where you are at the end of 2021 is no better than where you were at the end of 2020. Where your marriage is at the end of 2021 is no better than where it was at the end of 2016. Where your financial position is at the end of 2021 is no better than it was at the end of 2020. Maybe you feel lost in your dating life. Maybe you feel lost in a relationship. Maybe you feel lost in your career. You took this new job this year thinking it was the more money and more responsibility was going to heal some of the stuff that was going on in your heart. And what you've realized is it hasn't. And you're stepping back and going, what did I trade in for what I'm getting? And maybe you feel lost. Can I just tell you that the wonder of Christmas is going to be found as you stop looking around at your circumstances and you start looking up to God. Maybe you're not lost in your marriage. Maybe you're not lost in your career. Maybe you're not lost in your finances. Maybe there's just 10 stops between you and your destination. maybe there's just one more stop before you actually see God's plan or hear God's voice or find God's direction. And so focus on the star. See, God is guiding and God is leading. The question is, are we aware? Are we following? Most of the time when I feel lost in my life, it's not a matter of whether or not God is speaking. It's not a matter of whether or not God is guiding. It's a matter of, where am I humble enough to listen? Do I have the humility to listen and the courage to obey? Next, fall down and worship him. Fall down and worship him. Do you feel overwhelmed this Christmas? What was amazing for me this week is I kind of looked at the Christmas story, and every year at Christmas time, I sit down and I just say, God, I need something fresh. It's the same story, same passage of scripture. I just need you to give me something new, not for you, for me. And one of the things that I noticed this year that I haven't really noticed before is how central worship is to the Christmas story. Angels, shepherds, wise men, Mary, Joseph, they all take time in their own way to worship Jesus. The angels do it with glory and splendor. The shepherds do it as they share what was shared with them. Mary treasured all of these things in her heart. The wise men brought expensive gifts to Jesus of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And what you need to know tonight is how you worship is not nearly as important as your choice to worship. Like, how you worship God in your life is not nearly as important as your choice to humble yourself and to acknowledge that there is a God and it's not you. And what happens when we choose to fall down and worship is we acknowledge that I can't fix the broken parts of my life. No matter how hard I try, no matter how in control I think I am, no matter how much money I make, no matter how successful I feel like I am in my career, no matter how great my life is going, there are broken parts of me that I can't fix. And so when I choose to fall down and worship, I acknowledge that God is the only person that can recenter my life. God is the only person that can allow me to experience the wonder that I was created to experience. See, wonder is restored through worship. And no matter how amazing you are, you can't be amazed long-term in this life if you're at the center of your life. Worship recenters our life around Jesus, and it restores the wonder of Christmas. It reminds us that we weren't designed to be the gift. We were designed to be the receiver of the gift. And finally, receive the gift of Jesus this Christmas. Let me ask you, do you need a Savior this Christmas? I think for all of us that we've had to reorient ourselves to the new realities that we live in, at work, at school, even in the grocery store. There's a new heaviness in our culture. And what I think the pandemic did is it didn't create marriage problems, it illuminated them. Pandemic did not create problems at your job, it just highlighted them. Right? The pandemic probably didn't create, for the most part, financial stress. It just shined a light on the financial stress that you already had. It intensified it. And I think we can get to this place where we think, okay, if I can just do better, if I can just work harder, if I can just be more, I can be a better husband, I can be a better father, I can be a better wife, I can be a better mom, I can be a better employee. And maybe you're just exhausted this Christmas. And you don't need a self-help book, and you don't need a conference to go to for your job, and you don't even need, you know, 5 happy hops to a great marriage. What you need tonight is a Savior. And I just have some good news for you. Your gift is not 10 stops away. Your gift has arrived. Your gift is here. See, Jesus has already been given. Look at Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6 again. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. See, a gift is not a gift. It's only a present until you receive it. Then it becomes a gift. And God's already given his son. You don't have to earn it. You don't have to perform for it. You don't have to be guilt-tripped into it. You don't have to be perfect enough or good enough or produce enough or impress enough. Long before you ever existed, God had a special delivery waiting for you. See, Christmas is about God's relentless search for you. Maybe you thought you were coming here tonight for God, and God has been waiting here for you all day. He's been searching for you. And maybe every single thing that you've encountered, every single hurt that you've accumulated, every single wound that you've endured, every single broken part of your life that has brought you to this point, it hasn't been God doing it to you, it has been God waiting for you. I'm 3 stops away. I'm 2 stops away. The gift has arrived. And if you'd like to restore the wonder of Christmas, maybe you just need a Savior. Can we just close our eyes as we close tonight? And I don't want to leave this moment tonight without giving some of you the opportunity to receive Jesus into your life. Maybe you would consider yourself a religious person. Maybe you would consider yourself a good person, and you think, well, man, the good things in my life outweigh the bad things, so I'm good with God. But then there's this part of your heart, there's this part of your soul that is just really uneasy, because you know that you're not connected to God. You know that you connect with God a couple times a year. Maybe tonight you need forgiveness. Maybe tonight you need a fresh start. Maybe tonight you need grace. Maybe tonight you need the gift that God has been longing to send you all along. And tonight, as you sit here, it's just one notification. Your gift has arrived. But will you receive it? And so if you'd like to receive Jesus this Christmas, if you'd like to make him the Lord of your life and to ask him to forgive your sins and to ask him to make you whole, and to wipe your slate clean, I want to give you that opportunity right now. You don't have to come forward. You don't have to do anything except raise your hand and say, God, I know that you're one prayer away. I want to receive your grace. I want to receive your gift tonight. If that's you tonight, would you just raise your hand right where you're at? This is between you and God. It's not between you and the person next to you. It's not even between me and you. It's between you and God. God, I want to receive your son this Christmas. God, we come to you tonight challenged in our culture with wonder. Amazement is hard to come by. We're not as easy to impress as we were when we were younger. And so would you strip away our cynicism? Would you strip away our brokenness and allow us to embrace the gift of Christmas, the wonder of Christmas, the awe of your son taking on our sin, becoming sin on our behalf, humbling himself. God, would you allow us to restore the wonder that you long for us to live in every single day? We love you and we thank you for the gift of Christmas. In Jesus' name, amen.
No crowds were waiting, no royal celebration, just a humble father and a blessed young mother, and the sound of hope and peace from the cries of a homeless king. The angels sang, glory in the highest. The wise men came, 'cause they knew you were the one. And the shepherds watched with eyes full of wonder. The king has come, our Savior.
from the cries of heaven's King.
Oh, the angels sing, glory in the highest, the wise men came, 'cause they knew you were the one, and the shepherds saw with eyes full of wonder, the King has come, Jesus, my Savior, our Savior.
Fall on your knees, He is here, Jesus is here. Christ is the Lord, He is here, Jesus is here. Yeah, yeah. Fall on your knees, He is here, Jesus is here.
Well, Hope City family, as we conclude our service together, one of our favorite things to do is a tradition around here is singing Silent Night together as we light candles and stand together with our family. And if it's just you tonight, I want you to know that you are so valued and cherished. And as you light your candle, I want that to be a reminder that His light is for you. So I want to invite you to stand. And as you do, look around at your people. Right? And all the crazy and the fun and the oh my goodness, that in the silent night, hope is found. So let's sing this together.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm.
Sigh.
Silent night, holy night, Son of God, love's pure light, radiant beams from thy holy face.
Lift this up together, just our voices.
Silent night, holy night, wondrous star, lend thy light with the angels.
Just see the lights that are lit, that you are reminded that you are part of an amazing story, that for unto us a child is born and hope has been given. So what we want to say to you before you leave is, my family, 1, 2, 3, Merry Christmas. Ready? 1, 2, 3, yeah. Merry Christmas. Hope City family, have a great, great Christmas. We love you so much.